Thank you. Yeah. say good morning to everyone who's assembled here with us this morning. And I would like to welcome you to Shalom Kingdom Community Church. The Word of God tells us that He's not just a man, that He is God, and He's not just a lamb, but He is the Lion in the tribe of Judah.
Oh, yeah.
And what greater invitation can we give Him to just come and take a seat with us, just invite Him to be and share in this space with us. We thank God for that time of praise and worship, but it's not over as we continue to worship God throughout today's service. I would like to welcome anyone who's visiting here with us for the first time. If this is your first time here with us at Shalom Kingdom Community Church, if you would just stand or wave your hand so that we can see who you are. Amen. It's a blessing to have you all with us this morning. We hope that you already feel welcome and free in our house. But on behalf of our pastor, Elder Bill Hawkins, and our First Lady, Sister Teresa Hawkins, you are all welcome this morning. God bless you. Good morning. Your announcements for this morning are as follows. On this Friday, October 30th, we will be having our Hallelujah Fest here in Shalom from 6 to 8 p.m. We are still asking each family to donate a large bag of candy by Thursday, October 29th. If you can't get it here by Thursday, just bring it on Friday night when you come. And also on this Saturday, October 31st, there will be a ministry leaders meeting at 10 a.m. Also, I'd like to say happy birthday to those who have celebrated their birthday for the month of October, and also happy anniversary for our anniversary recipients. And for our sick and shut-in and recovery members, we do have Brother Kenya Williams is scheduled for shoulder surgery on this Thursday, October 29th. Continue to keep Brother Anthony Johnson lifted up in prayer, and also Brother Michael Carroll Sr. lifted up in prayer. He did have knee surgery, I heard, this past week, so we'll continue to keep him lifted up in prayer. And also for our, I'd like to let you all know that your announcements and upcoming events will be on the church's website. So you can go to the church website for your upcoming events and also our calendar events. And also our streaming live website address will be in the bulletin next month. So for all of that information, will be in our bulletin, also on our church website. So those are your announcements for this morning.
Amen. Praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, let's give the Lord praise. Amen. The house of the Lord. Amen. Thank God for His presence in this place. Amen. Praise God. Nothing like being in the presence of the Lord. Amen. That's what's so unique to the body of Christ, is that we have a time of worship. Amen. We have a time where we can come together, spend time together, and corporately worship the Lord together. Amen. How many know your neighbor can gain strength from you? Amen. The neighbor can gain strength from your praise, from your worship, and thank God for an atmosphere, amen, that has been set already so this move of God can take place in the house of God. Amen. How many have just already been blessed already this morning? Amen. Praise God. You know, I don't know about you, but I live to worship Him, live to give Him praise, amen. It adds value to my life, amen, and sustenance. So thank God for the people of God, amen, who worship our God. Amen. Praise the Lord. We are quickly leaving the month of October, quickly approaching the month of November. Amen. We want to remind everybody that we're excited about Friday night. Amen. Hallelujah night. Come on, let's give the Lord a praise. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Amen. We thank God, but we're certainly interested in the family here in this ministry, and amen, and our children. Amen. Making sure that they grow up in the admonition of the Lord. Amen. So we just decided to come together. Amen. Praise God for our Christian education department and have something in-house. Amen. Praise God for our kids. Amen. Amen. We'll have candy here. Amen. I heard we have a strong message coming from a secret agent. Amen. I can't give away, amen, in the name right now. You have to be here. Amen. Be a part of what God is doing. How many excited about what God is doing? Amen. It is the lives of our children. Amen. God is blessing us. Amen. Right now. So let's remember to support that. All of you that have our ministry leaders that need to turn in your budget, amounts for the year 2016. We have many already turned in. Please, amen, if you can't turn them in by this afternoon, make sure that your numbers are in by Tuesday night, amen, so we can set the budget. This is our planning month. We're planning it this month for what we will do, amen, in the year 2016, amen. How many know you can't wait to the last minute, amen, praise God, to do anything, amen, but you have to prepare ahead of time, amen, for the vision that's to come in the house, amen, so that the Lord can give us his direction, amen. Amen. As it was already said on the announcements, we are streaming live now, and the information to the website and all that you will need to know will be in the bulletin from here on out. Amen. Praise the Lord. Last Sunday service is now on YouTube. So we're getting out, we're getting around, and we want God's this ministry to be, amen, a blessing to people all across this nation. Amen. 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 Praise God. That's something you give God praise for right there. How many know when your ministry is a blessing to somebody, that is an opportunity for God to move on their heart, amen, to sow seed, amen, praise God. There might be a millionaire out there listening. Oh, y'all don't believe it. A millionaire can cancel the debt. Come on, somebody. Burn the mortgage. I don't need nobody. Amen. Praise God. So we're looking forward to what God, amen, is doing in the house of the Lord. Again, our website is shalomkcc.org. Shalomkcc.org. S-H-A-L-O-M-K-C-C.org. Amen. You can always go and visit our website. Amen. Praise God to be updated on information. Amen. Praise God. Amen. I think it's, I'd like to meet with all the ministry leaders for about 5 minutes after church today. All ministry leaders for about 5 minutes. Amen. After church today. Amen. If you'll grant me that opportunity. Amen. I promise you 5 minutes will be done. Amen. Praise God. It's offering time. It's offering time. Amen. Amen. How many know we serve a God of provision? I didn't hear nobody. How many know we serve a God of provision? And wherever there is vision, God's vision, there is provision. Do I have any witnesses here? And if you are on God's mission, on God's purpose, on purpose for God of your life, it's a life of purpose for God, amen, then God will provide all your needs according to his riches and glory, amen, by Christ Jesus. Now, this is what we're going to do today. We have a new member in our presence today. Amen. Praise God. By the name of Everett Marsh. Everett Marsh. Come on, give us a call of praise for him. Amen. Amen. Praise God. He said he came into this church. He heard the word of God. He heard the music. He liked what he heard. The Lord spoke to him. Amen. And told him to become a part of this local assembly. Come on, let's give God a praise. Amen. For him. Amen. He has met with me in new members' orientation and have signed his covenant agreement to become a part, amen, of this local assembly. Amen. So we thank God for him. So you know how we do it here. Amen. Once we come and present our offering. Amen. Praise God. I want you to go back to your seat, and I want everybody to face the wall on this side and this side. Face across and just join away. One big line. We're going to have Brother Everett to come. Amen. We're going to offer to him the right hand of fellowship. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Come on. Give him praise in the house of God. Amen. For what he's doing. Amen. In the lives of his people. Amen. Praise God. This time, let's stand. Amen, amen. Praise God. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you're the God of provision. God, that everything we have, you have provided it for us. And everything that will come to us will come because of you. And so, Lord, we come to you today with worship in our hearts. cheerfully, hilariously givers, Lord, because we've seen how your hand has already moved in our life, and we have an expectation, Lord, burning down in our souls, Lord, to what you will do in the days ahead. Lord, we thank you that you're a God of debt cancellation. Come on. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you can make a way out of no way. We thank you, Lord, that you're able, God, to move on the heart of the king, God, and turn it whichever way you choose to, Lord. So we come today, God, expecting, God, you to do something in our lives, Lord, you to bless us in a way, God, that only you can. So, Lord, as we come now, Lord, bless your people as they come by faith. In Jesus' mighty name, church said, amen. In the hands of the elders. Thank you.
thing is all in prayer. The tender every day, I'll watch you while I pray.
Thank you.
Amen. Why y'all singing? Y'all singing. You all are not singing. Y'all is singing. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Praise the Lord. See, just wait on the Lord and be of good courage. And God's going to work it out. Come on, somebody. Come on, God is doing it. The Lord is doing it. And we let the Lord do it, it turns out all right. Do I have a witness? Amen, amen. Praise God. Thank God for His word. Thank God for the people of God, our visitors. Thank God for you today. Amen. I hope you know that you're welcome by now. Thank God for our brothers that have joined with us. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Now, before I move any further, I want the deacons to stand up. Let me see my deacons. Amen. Brother Everett, you see these brothers here? They're going to help me take good care of you. Amen. Amen. And this is Brother Glenn here. This is the musician, as you can see, the ministry leader of our choir department. So I want you to meet him after church. Because Brother Everett said he can sing, brother. I heard a little bass in his voice back there. You may be seated. I heard a little bass in his voice. Amen. I'm going to leave that alone. Y'all was trying to pull me in, but no, sir. Not today. Chapter 45. Praise God. Praise God. I felt the presence in this place today. From morning until now. Praise God. Start reading at verse 16, Genesis 45, 16 through 28. If you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Now the report of it was heard in Pharaoh's house, saying, Joseph's brothers has come. So it pleased Pharaoh and his servants well. Pharaoh said to Joseph, say to your brothers, do this. Load your animals and depart. Go to the land of Canaan. Bring your father and your household and come to me. I will give you the best of the land of Egypt. You will eat the fat of the land. Now you are commanded to do this. Take carts out of the land of Egypt for your little ones and your wives. Bring your father and come. Also, do not be concerned about your goods, for the best of all the land of Egypt is yours. Then the sons of Israel did so, and Joseph gave them carts according to the command of Pharaoh, and he gave them provisions for the journey. Somebody said provisions.
Provisions.
He gave to all of them, each man, changes of garments. But to Benjamin he gave 300 pieces of silver and 5 changes of garments. And he said to his father these things, 10 donkeys loaded with good things of Egypt, and 10 female donkeys loaded with grain, bread, and food for his father for the journey. So he sent his brothers away, and they departed. He said to them, see that you do not become troubled along the way. Then they went up out of Egypt and came to the land of Canaan to Jacob their father. And they told him, saying, Joseph is still alive, and he is governor over all the land of Egypt. And Jacob's heart stood still because he did not believe them. But when they told him all the words which Joseph had said to them, and when he saw the carts which Joseph had sent to carry him, the spirit of Jacob, their father, revived. Then Israel said, it is enough. Joseph, my son, is alive. I will go and see him before I die. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We've been sharing on the last several weeks the life of Joseph and how it demonstrates to us how the purpose and the plan of God works for his people. Joseph was a man of purpose. Purpose means that there was an intended end for his life. There was something that God was going to use the life of Joseph to facilitate his will and his purpose. Purpose is the drive, the force that drives us. If your life is on purpose, then there ought to be a drive in your heart, a desire to continually exercise your faith. At the end of the day, we've said it before that your greatest sin is unbelief. Because unbelief ties the hand of God. And so what does faith do? Release the hand of God in your life. Amen. And I'm going to announce to all of us today that all of our lives are a life of purpose. Originally, the purpose of man was to glorify God. That's simple, isn't it? Amen. To glorify God. Amen. What does glorify God mean? It's to illuminate him in the earth. To cause him to shine bright. The original plan of man was that man would come and spread the influence of heaven on earth. That's glorifying God. When you take a God that cannot be seen by the physical eye and allow him to work in your life, then he's working purpose in you. And the purpose that he's working in you is ultimately that he might be glorified. That somebody might see God in you. God gets glory. God gets pleasure out of the will of God being done in the life of his people. And so purpose of man is to glorify God. So all of us have the same purpose when it comes to mankind. And that is to allow God to work in our lives that he might be seen, that he might be noticed, that people, your peers and associates and constituents, might notice God in you and desire to meet the God that you know. A God that can also give them purpose. Come on, somebody. Sometimes there are people in the world that God is setting up for his kingdom. Come on, somebody. Everything that you've been through while you've been out in the world was setting you up for purpose. Come on, somebody. That's why you don't despise your past. You allow your past, amen, to be submitted to God's will, and God can take your past and give you purpose. God doesn't wait all the time till we're saved to work purpose in our life. He begins from the time of birth. He told Jeremiah, I knew you before you were conceived in your mother's womb. Come on, somebody. God saw you. God saw me. And God have called us into his kingdom for such a time as this because God has a purpose for your life. Somebody ought to say amen. Amen. And you've got to have that in your spirit as an individual. You've got to believe God, that God has purpose for your life. Amen. Praise God. Isaiah 43:7. Even everyone that is called by my name, for I have created him for my glory. I have formed him. Yea, I have made him. Purpose is not what you do. It is the effect of what you do has on people. Purpose is not what you do, it is the effect that what you do has on people. Got it? The palace was not Joseph's purpose. The palace was a vehicle for purpose to be released. Come on, somebody. And so, if I can add on to what we've already said already, that the pit was the place of separation. Potiphar's house was the place of persecution. Prison was the holy place, and the palace is the place of purpose. So today I want to end this lesson as it relates to using Joseph's life with the purpose today now. The purpose. purpose that Joseph experienced, all that he experienced. His life was on purpose. Your life is on purpose, whether you realize it or not. Amen. And as soon as you, amen, learn to exercise your faith in that area, then God will give you the revelation of what it is you should be doing. God will give you something that you are passionate about. God will give you something that you can be good at. Come on. That you can be uniquely and wonderfully made to do this. Amen. Praise God. There are 1,000 school teachers, but God have commissioned you for this place, this time, for this season in your life. And whenever you're in a season of purpose, then you can give God praise. Amen. You can thank God that even though I'm going through hell, even though I'm facing opposition, even though sometimes I wonder, Lord, why you brought me here, at the end of the day, as long as I know I'm on purpose, I can give God the glory. My life is worth living. Come on, somebody. Because my life is on purpose. Matthew chapter 22, verse 37 through 40. Jesus said unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, thy soul, and thy mind. This is the first commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. So again, purpose. Purpose is to glorify God. And how is God glorified? When you let him sit in the first place seat of your heart. When you elevate him to the highest authority in your life, then your relationship with him will give you revelation of who he is, of who you are, and then you'll be able to have right relationships with your neighbors. One of the two signs that you know God is your relationships. Because when you know how to have a relationship with a person, then you understand that the relationship that you have is based off the principles and the laws of God's kingdom in your heart, then you'll treat people right. See? So if I keep God first and God shows me myself, shows me the revelation of who he is in my life, then that causes me to handle my earthly relationships better. He said if you get your vertical relationship right, then all your horizontal relationships will come into tact. That's a sign right there. That's a sign right there. If nobody gets along with you,
thank you, Lord God.
If nobody likes you, if you're always in some mess, you need to consider your relationship with God. Because when God is out of order, your life is out of order. Until you put God back in the center, all these other side relationships are not going to work. See, it's a difference to be persecuted because of righteousness and persecuted because nobody likes you. Come on, somebody. It's a difference for somebody hating on me because the favor of God is on my life, like Joseph's brother hating on him. That's a different kind of persecution. But when you can't seem to get nobody on your side, when nobody wants to pick you on their team, you keep wondering why you didn't get invited to the birthday party, there's a reason. See, people that give God the glory are attractive.
Yes.
People that allow God out become attractive to the people around them. Because it's not really that you all at the bag of chips, it's the God in you.
That's right.
Come on, somebody. Because me in my own right, I will cuss you out. Say amen. The main ones that say amen is the main one cussing. In the street, nobody knows you. If it's up to me, I'll cuss you out. But the God in me allows me to release peace, joy, love. Come on, somebody. It's the Lord that have done this thing.
That's
come
right.
on, somebody.
That's right.
And that's the joy and the wonderful thing about being in God's kingdom is that he can transform my life into somebody attractive. What do you mean? Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be attracted to you. See, you use too much energy when you go after stuff. Your energy should be used in going after righteousness. What is righteousness? Believe in Jesus Christ. Him that knew no sin became sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God. You have become the righteousness of God, not because you stopped smoking and drinking, but because Jesus died. Amen. Let's just get that straight out. Let's get that right straight out the gate.
Thank you, Jesus.
The fact that you stopped some stuff, that was good for your own praise itself. So you keep doing the stuff you're doing, you're going to kill your little self. You did that because you got revelation that you need to cut some stuff off or you kill yourself. Touch your neighbor and say, you're not killing yourself, are you? Not only do we have a purpose to glorify God corporately as a mankind, as a nation, we also have a personal purpose. Listen to what Jeremiah 29:11 says. For I know the thoughts I think toward you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil. To give you an expected end. Did y'all hear that? To give you an expected end. That means that as an individual, don't try to be somebody else. Be who God made you. What's your crazy stuff? Don't let nobody steal your craziness. You know what craziness is? Your uniqueness. Don't let somebody steal the fact that you're unique and you're different from the other people in your little group. Come on, somebody. Because you know what they're afraid of? They're afraid that if you ever reach your potential, if you ever really just stand up and be who God made you, amen, then they're going to be left far behind. Come on, somebody. That's why Joseph had to be separated from his peers. He had to be separated from the people that had a potential to stop him or to be a stumbling block to what God was doing in his life. Let me tell you something. It's got to come a point in your life where it's more than about religion. It's more about coming to church because I'm going to feel bad if I don't go, and I'm going to feel good if I do go. Because a whole lot of people have been feeling good for 20 years and still nothing changed in their life. Going to church got to be more about me feeling good that I didn't miss church today. Going to church has to have a purpose. The purpose of the church is that I might be perfected, that I might be matured so I can do the work of the ministry. Where's the work of the ministry done? In the marketplace. In the places where you frequent. Wherever God has your little body is where he wants to use you. Can you present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God? In other words, can you make this a vessel of honor? Can you make this a vessel that's worthy of the vocation in which you've been called? If you realize the call on your life and the purpose of God on your life, you wouldn't take this little body anywhere. This is the vehicle of God's glory. This is the vehicle on how God gets himself in and out of the earth. Through your body. Through my body. And so once we recognize the importance of our bodies, then it might have us to reconsider some things. Might have us to be more strong and have more courage to stand, because we know that this body is supposed to end up in the palace. This body wasn't meant to stay in the pit. This body wasn't meant to stay in Potiphar's house. This body wasn't meant to stay in prison. This body was made for the palace. Touch your neighbor and say, this body was made for the palace. Don't you stay in the pit. Don't you keep messing around in Potiphar's house. Don't give up in your holding place. Because the day of the palace is coming in your life. And the reason why the day of the palace is coming into your life is because God has a purpose for your life. See, God protected his promise. God is a protector of his promises. God promised Abraham. Come on, y'all got to get this, because that's why we call Abraham the father of faith. Because if you obey his example, if you follow his example, if you allow the story of his life to mentor you, then you will come into the place of purpose.
Abram, I'm going to bless you. Not only am I going to bless you, I'm going to cause you to be a blessing to other people. See, when my relationship is right with him, then not only am I blessed, but I become a blessing. Stop thinking that God is trying to take something away from you to give it to somebody else. That is not God's process. God is trying to give you abundance so you have more than enough. Come on, somebody. You don't mind giving away a couple of $100s if you got a few thousand. Come on, somebody. When you're scrambling, when you're going through, when it's tough, amen, praise God, it might be a little bit more difficult. But God said, if you'll work with me, if you'll work on your faith, if you'll let me build purpose in you, amen, then I'll cause things to be attracted to you and you'll always have more than enough. That's another level of living, y'all. Not this stuff we're talking about. Another level of living is I have realized something. God has changed my heart. It is no longer just about me. It's about the people around me. Come on, somebody. It's no greater feeling than walk up on the scene and be able to bless everybody around you. Say amen. Amen. If you ain't had that experience, you're going to have it. So say amen like you mean it.
Amen.
That's purposey. That's what I got to know. I've got to know that if my heart is right towards God, and I'm not living life on purpose, that he's going to add to me. Why? So I can be a blessing to somebody else. Abraham, I'm going to bless you, and I'm going to make you a blessing. Listen, the highest level of blessing is not the fact that you are blessed. The highest level of blessing is that other people are blessed because of you.
Amen. That's right.
Come on, somebody. Amen. These simple principles, if we get these right, man, we're going to blow up. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, are you ready to blow up? Don't you let no religious tradition, don't you let some idea, amen, that some man or some woman has made up, amen, praise God, stop you from being liberated in the things of God. Come on, somebody. I found out the more I serve God, amen, not only do I have enough for me, but I have enough for others too. And so when you get that purpose in your heart that you're going to be a blessing to other folks, Lord, I'm going to let you use me to bless other people. Guess what? I ain't never come up lacking.
Amen.
Never come up lacking. It's always enough to give away, and seem like the more I give away, the more I get.
Amen.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Now, this ain't Santa Claus now. This ain't a Santa Claus gospel. This is a faith gospel.
Amen.
This is a seeking the kingdom of God and his righteousness gospel. And then these things will be added.
Amen.
When things are added to you, nobody can take them away.
Amen.
But God. If God gave it to you, he's the only one that can take it away.
Amen.
So let's do ourselves a favor. Stop saying God gave us stuff that we went out and got ourselves. He said, Abraham, your seed will be blessed. Listen to Genesis 15, verse 4 through 6. And behold, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, this shall not be thine heir, but he that shall come forth out of thine own bowels shall be thine heir. And he brought him forth abroad and said, look now toward heaven and tell the stars, if thou be able to number them. And he said unto him, so shall thy seed be. And he believed in the Lord, and he counted it unto him as righteousness. So what is righteousness? A bunch of do's and don'ts? Or is righteousness my ability to believe God? If it was accounted unto Abraham before the law ever came as righteousness because of his faith. You are righteous because of your faith.
Amen.
Not because of what you do and do not do. Because if you keep exercising your faith, everything that you don't need to do, you will begin to gain power over it. You will graduate from these little gnats flying around your ear. It's time for you to at least graduate from gnat faith to mosquito faith. He's a little bigger, he bite a little harder. Righteousness comes because of my ability and my decision I made to trust God's word, even when it takes me through changes, even when it causes me to look at myself in the mirror and be honest with myself. Sometimes you just gotta look in the mirror and say, you look mean. Sometimes you gotta look yourself in the mirror and say, you look stingy. Sometimes you gotta look yourself and say, this is all about you. See, once you start really, really confronting yourself, you'll see your need for the Lord. Nobody had to tell you. Nobody had to make you feel bad. Nobody had to discourage you. If you do a self-evaluation every now and then, and be true to thine own self, brutally honest, you can save yourself years of frustration and disappointment. I love to tell the Lord about myself. Some of you already know. He already know you. He know you're going in and coming out. The question is, do you know you? See, when I confess my sins, when I confess my shortcomings, when I talk to God about my idiosyncrasies and my proclivities and my problems, then he can do something about it.
Amen.
I tell God, not because he don't know, but because he wants to know that I know. And the minute he know that I know, then he can offer me support.
Amen.
Stop trying to freak God out.
Amen.
Stop trying to act holy and be holy. Holy means that I'm trusting God. That's the essence of holiness, my faith in God. Not my long dress, napkin on my head, cotton stockings, and pilgrim shoes, and speaking in tongues. That don't make you holy. The people you think that ain't holy are the main ones that's holy. What does holiness mean? Doing it God's way. Being shaped and molded into what God's character looks like. Last I checked, God was a God of peace, love, joy, all these things. Against these things there is no law. He's saying, when I develop you, if you allow me to develop you spiritually, then there'll be nothing you have to be afraid of. Because everything in your heart elevates you past the place that you're always down here struggling with. So I encourage you, you want to take heed to God's word because you are a person of purpose. That God, like he saw Jeremiah, the weeping prophet, even though Jeremiah had to carry a word that the people wasn't ready for, amen, God called him to do that, and as long as he did that, God was moving him into the place of purpose.
Amen.
He said, man, Abraham, I'm making you a promise. This blessing I'm going to put on you will go down to all out eternity.
Amen.
And now, look at God. God is protecting his promise here in Joseph's life. God is protecting the thing that he promised Abraham. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Now Jacob is sitting in a place, amen, in Canaan land, the place of promise, amen, in a famine. Going through changes. The man of God, the man of promise, going through changes. Let me first say to you, amen, praise God, that just because you got purpose in your life don't mean you're going through changes. As a matter of fact, you're not going through changes. As a matter of fact, expect to go through changes. Touch your neighbor and say, expect to go through changes. If you got an ounce of anointing on you, you're going through changes. If you got any intent to exercise your faith, you're going through changes. Come on, somebody. Don't be surprised. Be not dismayed. Whatever be tied, the Lord will make a way somehow. Come on, somebody. Only people that don't expect challenges in their life don't have any faith. But people that understand faith and understand God's kingdom, not only do they understand that challenges are coming, but they know how to handle themselves in the challenge. Come on, somebody. That's what God is trying to get you to be able to handle your challenges, amen, so that your faith might increase.
Amen.
Storms come into our life that we might be perfected or corrected. If you know you ain't been doing right, What is not doing right, y'all? Not doing right is failing to believe God.
Yeah.
That's the essence. Everything else is surface. In the core of it, what does the devil do? Come into your mind and tell you that God is upset with you. Every time you fail or you come up short or things don't happen like you planned them to happen, that's the time for the enemy to get in right then. Because if he can make you doubt God's word, if you're struggling in the area of provision, and he said, I am Jehovah Jireh, the Lord God, your provider, are you going to believe that he's your provider, or are you going to look at your situation and fade in your belief? Because when you fade in your belief, you know what we start doing? We start trying to work it out.
Amen.
That's the worst thing you can do, is try to work it out without God. See? Those are the times that you need to believe God the most, when your life is the worst. That's the time that God is testing you to see what you're going to do.
Yes.
Bad boy, bad boy. What you gonna do? What you gonna do when he come for you? Because as long as you're exercising faith, you're gonna suffer persecution. First and foremost, by the devil. How does the devil persecute you? By making you believe something other than what God told you. If God told you you were the head and not the tail, are you going to believe that in spite of adversity, or the first little wind to blow your way? Are you going to give up on your faith and try to work it out yourself? That's what God had to do in Joseph's life here. He had to prepare him for the palace. He had to prepare him for purpose. God is preparing you for purpose. Come on, somebody. And you ever notice how a lot of things are going good in your life, but there's always one thing? Oh, you ain't got to say amen. I say amen. Amen, lights. You ever notice that your money could be all right and things would be going all right, but there's always something nipping at your nose? Something always pulling on your life? Whether it be a relationship, whether it be your money can be right here, the car driving good, the house arranger is nice, and you just a relationship that seems like you just can't shake. Come on, somebody. It's always something that's always trying to pull us under, isn't it? Come on, somebody. The iniquities of our forefathers. Amen. Praise God. Weaknesses that attack our families. Come on, somebody. I know you cute and your family are all that, but everybody's family is attacked with a weakness. Amen. Might be kleptomania. Uncle Jimmy stole. Junebug stole. Now little George is stealing.
Already.
See. Everybody got something that's continually persecuting them. But what is God doing in the midst of your persecution? He's seeing what you're going, are you going to exercise your faith? Amen. One way you exercise your faith is say what the word of God says out your mouth in spite of what you're looking at. Amen. People can call me praise all you want to. Yes, I talk to myself. Yes, I talk to myself. And I said, self? So myself said I. You got some changing to do. You got some growing up to do. You got some things in your life that you got to deal with. Come on, somebody, because as the grace of God increases in your life, the more he gives you power over your iniquity. The more power you have to say no. The one thing about that drug, when you go on that drug is hard to say, just say no. Come on, just say no. Evidently, you ain't never been on cloud nine. You know, I don't get tired of people up trying to preach about somebody that's been on drugs and they ain't never been on drugs. Shut up. You don't know what you're talking about.
Come on.
Don't try to tell my story. Let me tell it. Your story too pretty. Your story got too much icing on it. Let me get ugly with it. Let me tell you how it really is. Because can't nobody get free if you're up there fronting. Fronting won't get you free. Reality will get you free. Because if you can't go down low enough to pick somebody up, you reaching all over top of people's head. Come on, somebody. Every now and then you gotta get down in the ditch with them. I don't care what you say, that's the kingdom of God. Because if I can't tell you how rough it was when I stayed up all night and slept all day, then I can't identify with you. Now when I talk to folks, then I know the struggle with Jordan, they say, yeah, I used to be a vampire too, man. Sister Sunshine, when I tell them I was a vampire, they know exactly what that means. Vampires come out at night and go to sleep in the daytime. Vampires are looking out the window at 7 a.m., they closing blinds. People walking to the bus stop, driving, going to work, the vampire, he's closing the blind now. He want everything dark in the house, got to block all the light out. That's sad. If I can't talk to somebody about reality, how am I going to help them out? Because when they see that I went through the same thing, when they see that I was a vampire, when they see that I was all the pieces, upside down, tore up from the floor up, and then now I got them. Now I got you where I want you. Then I can tell you what happened to me after that. Something happened to me. I met this man from Galilee named Jesus.
Come on.
And when I met the man from Galilee, He flipped me topsy-turvy. The more I trusted him, I was just trying to do the right thing. The more I trusted him, the more he was doing something supernatural in my heart. And next thing I know, I'm not the same man that I used to be. Come on, I got me a testimony. Touch your neighbor, I got me a testimony. That's what's wrong with some of y'all men. You scared of your testimony. You too cute to tell your testimony. Three things we need to learn out of this as I hasten. Number one, God's purpose in your life is always greater than you. God's purpose in your and myself, our lives, is always greater than us. That's a great thing because my purpose is taking me to a place that I could not go on my own. That's what I'm trying to get y'all to see. The very thing that's in your heart that you want to do in life, God gave it to you. You just don't know how to get there. You think by coming to God, God is going to take it away because your way of getting there don't seem like it's God's way. You don't realize as you submit your ways unto the Lord, He will establish your goal. Because listen, let me tell you something. Some people want something they're not ready for. Because when you elevate to that next level, you're going to see some things. Your eyes shall see some things they ain't never seen before. And you're going to be like, really? This what's going on up here? Next thing you know, you sprung. God is saying, the way to get there is to allow me to develop you in faith so when you get there, I won't lose you. So when you get there and they come for you, you will be able to what? Stand. Come on, somebody. This ain't about throwing blows no more. This is about taking a stand for righteousness, taking a stand according to a standard. No, I will not. But everybody doing it. Well, no, I know the Lord. But such and such in there saved, but I don't let them be saved then. I'm not going. I'm not going to do it. Why? Because I know I'm on purpose. I know that God has me here doing something. Come on, somebody. God is up to something in me. And I've got to hold on to God's unchanging hand. Even though temptation comes to my life, I've got to be built enough to stand against the temptation. Or else I'll be swallowed up like a whole lot of these folks. Started off saying they love Jesus. Now they think they love Allah. They're all the pieces. Yes. Because they have not been established in faith. Amen. Come on, somebody. God's purpose in your life is always greater than you. Joseph was raised up not so he could look and be important, but for the greater cause of preserving the seed of Abraham. Joseph's journey started with a dream and a vision from God, where God was taking him with required faith and patience. Notice, in Abraham's life, it took 25 years before he received the promised Isaac. Joseph's life, it took 13 years from the time he had the dream to the time he entered into the palace. Don't be so concerned with the end that you fail to develop along the way. Don't be so worried about what God is going to do in the end, but learn how to enjoy the journey. Learn how to gather from your life experiences that you need is going to keep you when you reach the palace. Come on, somebody. See, that's a person of vision. They already know that where they're going is a high place. We're going up to the high place to tear the devil's kingdom down. So when you get to the high place, you have to be establishing God by faith that you can deal with darkness. That you can deal with those around that have lost their way. That you can deal with those that have gotten caught up. They started off strong in the Lord, but somehow, some way, fame, somehow, some way, reputation have gotten in the way and caused them to stumble. Now they're sitting on the side of the road. That's why you're there. That's why God is sending you into hostile territory. That's why God is sending you into the high place so you can bring the stronghold of the devil down off of people's lives. Not so you can be rich and famous. Some of y'all want to be on Love and Hip Hop right now. Don't lie. That's your highest aspiration, baby. When I call the altar call, you come up here. Remember that what God is doing in your life is meant to have an effect on others. That's so simple, y'all, but so profound.
Yes.
Let me say that again. Remember that what God is doing in your life is meant to have an effect on others. Until you get past you, your four, and no more, then you're still in an early process of faith. See? And that's how we all start off. It's about us. It's about our family. It's about our money. It's about our blessing. It's about what God is going to do for me. But you'll find out, as you're elevated in faith, God turns it in your heart that it's no longer only about you, but it's about others. When you get to that point in your life that you know what God is doing in your life and what God is taking you is for other people, then you're growing in faith. You have got a revelation that it's not about me. It's about what God is doing. Because here's where the devil will trick us at. The devil will say, well, if you go that route, it's too slow. It's going to take too long. I heard God could move mountains. I heard God could change things in the twinkling of a moment, of a twinkling of an eye, and I'm just going through too long. God, I want you to give it to me now. God, I want you to do it now. Some of us, the best thing God could have said to us already in our life is no. Sometimes a no is to save your life. Sometimes the reason why you didn't get it was to save your life. Sometimes the reason why it looked like somebody moved in front of you and took what belonged to you, that was God setting a door. Because you were not ready to go through that door. Come on, somebody. He'll open up doors that no man can shut. When it's for you, it's for you. And he'll shut doors that no man can open. When you're on purpose, amen, your prayer should be, Lord, if this is for me, let it happen, God. But if this is not for me, shut the door. When was the last time you prayed, Lord, shut the door if it's not for me? Open the door, Lord, if it's for me, if it's not. Whenever you're going on a job interview, whenever you're going for a career move, whenever you get ready to make a major decision in your life, you ought to be prayed up when you go in there and say, Lord, I'm on purpose. So let your purpose manifest. That's another way of praying. I'm not asking God to give me anything. I'm not even asking him to give me the job. I'm asking him to say, Lord, let purpose be revealed. That way, if I ask him to let purpose be revealed, that means that if it wasn't for me, it's not going to be for me. So I don't leave mad. I don't leave upset. I don't leave discouraged. I leave praising God and say, Lord, that must have been another door you shut. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Come on, somebody. Have you ever praised God for shutting the door? Amen. Have you ever praised God for not exposing you in your mess? Have you ever praised God that if everybody else would have found out what you did, you would have been condemned and you wouldn't have been able to be on the deacon board no more? Amen. Have you ever praised God for what he didn't expose? Amen. Oh, I know y'all deep. Y'all ain't never did nothing. I'm talking to the wrong crowd. Amen. But every now and then I give God a thank you, praise Lord, but then let them, thank you, Lord, for not letting me be exposed. Amen. Oh, I know I can't get amens on that. This kingdom teaching here. This kingdom talking here. Amen. Praise God. Sometimes you can see somebody crying and going through changes. You don't know what the hell they've been through. You don't know the hell that they've been through. You don't know the battle they've been fighting. And you don't know how God worked it out. Come on, somebody. I wish I had somebody here that realized that God hadn't done it. It wouldn't have gotten done. God hadn't protected you. You wouldn't have been protected. If God would have let you be exposed, you would have been exposed. Amen. Because you know you did it. You know you did it. Praise God. But thanks be to God. He covered you in your mess. Thanks be to God. He didn't let it be so. Thanks be to God. You were on purpose in God's mind. And God knew that weeping might endure for a night. But joy is coming. Joy is coming, I tell you. So because you're on purpose, see, when you're on purpose, amen, that's not a license to sin. But every now and then, when you know you did something, you had to do that, nobody knew. God covered you in spite of yourself. Anybody that's just praising God, amen, for the good things that have happened, amen, they're not pure people of true faith. Because people of true faith praise God for the things he didn't let happen. You ever heard the old folks say, I thank him for protecting me from danger, seen and unseen. Come on, somebody. Even the things that was coming in my life to destroy me, because I'm on purpose, God stopped it short before it ever happened. Come on, somebody. Amen. Because when you're walking in purpose, you got some haters. Amen. You got some people that don't understand you. You got some people that don't get it. They're not supposed to get it. Stop trying to wait for everybody to get what God is doing in your life. When it's uniquely for you, people are not going to understand what God is doing in your life. So are you going to be influenced by the people and fail to respond to God? Or are you going to respond to God in spite of what people are going to say and what people are going to think and do what God? It takes courage, I tell you, to be a person of purpose. God is expecting what he's doing in your life to have an effect on other people. Joseph's life had an effect on his father, past generation, on his older brothers, current generation, and his younger brother and his sons, future generation. God was using Joseph's life to touch three generations. Come on, somebody. Listen, when you're a person of purpose, you're concerned about what's going to happen to your children. You're concerned about what's going to happen to your grandchildren. Come on, somebody. It's not about you anymore. It's about leaving a legacy. It's about leaving a heritage. It's about leaving something behind, because the Bible says a good man leave an inheritance for his children and his grandchildren. That's what I wanted to say over my grave. Just say he was a man of faith. Say he was a man, pray to God, that loved looking out for others. Come on. That he was a man that affected the next generation. Come on. That he gave a people something that God gave him to give them, and now he's resting in peace. Pray to God. Every time somebody dies, I'm going to talk about rest in peace. Let me leave that alone. Ain't done nothing their whole life. Come on, rest in peace. They troubled all the way through wherever they're going. Joseph's life affected three different generations. God's purpose in your life is greater than you. Number two, salvation is a part of God's plan. Salvation is a part of God's plan. In chapter 42, verses 21, and they said one to another, "We are very guilty concerning our brother, in that we saw the anguish of his soul when he besought us, and we would not hear. Therefore is this distress come upon us." And Reuben answered them and said, "Spake I not unto you, saying, do not sin against the child?" Now they're arguing, y'all. Now they're confessing. Now they're coming to a reality that what they have done had brought them to this place. "And you would not hear? Therefore, behold, also his blood is required." And they knew not that Joseph understood them, for they spake unto them by an interpreter. And he turned himself about from them and wept, and returned to them again, and communed with them, and took from them Simeon and bound him before their eyes. See, what God was doing here in the purpose of Joseph's life, all that he had went through had brought him to this place of purpose. And in purpose, you can see the wisdom of God. In purpose, see, that's another thing. When you have a purpose for God, you have a wisdom from on high. Come on, somebody. You have a wisdom and an understanding on how to use the knowledge you have to benefit you and to advance you. Come on, somebody. God will show you what to do, what to say, where you should go, who you should talk to, amen, when you're on purpose. Joseph saw them. Look at wisdom. Let me show that. Look at the wisdom of Joseph. He had an interpreter, even though he could speak Hebrew. If it would have been you, you would have broke right off in Hebrew language. "I remember y'all threw me in that pit. I remember y'all sold me off." That would have been you. But Joseph had been through a process now of patience and faith. And so now the wisdom of God works with you when you're working with God. When you work with God, God will work with you. When you're on God's purpose and connected to God's plan, then God will give you insight and knowledge and discernment and understanding. Come on, somebody. These are the blessings of God. The fact that you can discern. The fact that you know what to say. The fact that he gives you a plan of attack on how you're going to deal with this. He said, Joseph could have been broke off in Hebrew, but he had an interpreter in there so the plan could go right. God had him on a side net. God had him on a plan. And so, God just interpreted it. He knew what they're saying the whole time. They think he don't know because of the interpreter. But the whole time, Joseph is uncovering the hearts of his brothers. And so he heard him talking about, "Man, we done messed up. Lord, our brother's blood is required." What Joseph was able to see from the wisdom of God is their repentant heart. Because of Joseph's obedient heart, he was elevated to the seat of judgment. He could have done to his brothers whatever he saw fit, y'all. In judgment must reside the wisdom of God. See, if you allow God to build you in faith, then you, God will place you in a place of judgment because you have the ability to discern between good and evil. You have spiritual insight. That's another thing that comes with purpose, spiritual insight. And so he could have done to him anything he wanted to do, but God gave him a heart to judge. Joseph tested his brothers in order to reveal their heart. It was revealed that repentance was in their heart. Look at the story unfold. God had set them up with an opportunity to repent. Repentance brings about forgiveness. Did y'all hear what I said? Repentance opens the door for forgiveness. When you have a heart change, when you recognize where you come up short and where you've done wrong and where you exercise unbelief, then when you say, I need to do better, Lord, I need to turn this around, Lord. I know that I'm slacking in some areas. I know that I've come up short in some areas. When you truly recognize that and you want to get back on course and you want to get on God's purpose and you want to get lined up, then God will forgive you for your unbelief and cleanse you from all of your unrighteousness. See, at the moment he saw their repentance, he was moved with compassion, and forgiveness overwhelmed his heart. Repentance and forgiveness led to salvation. Salvation is a part of God's plan. When Joseph saw their repentant heart, that they hated, that they sold him off, then he said he was moved with compassion. The Bible said he ran off into a room and cried, sobbed dearly, because he saw the repentance in the heart of his brothers. And when he saw the repentance in the hearts of his brothers, it moved him to forgive them for what they had done against him. Their repentance led to his forgiveness, which led them to salvation. Number three, finally, the promises of God are sure. The promises of God are sure. God promised Abraham that he, his seed, would not only survive, but be great and greatly blessed. Isaac and Jacob were his seeds. Joseph, the seed of Jacob, was used to move God's people into position to walk in the promise. The family of God was saved and resting in the promises of God. So the whole while, Joseph's life was on purpose. It was not for him to get to the palace and live a good life. The Bible said that he had a wife. He had two children, Manasseh and Ephraim. Joseph could have got on his own, did well on his own, and forgot about God's purpose. See, the palace, just because you reach the palace don't mean that you come to the place of purpose. You still got to do what God told you to do at the end of the day. The whole reason for these stages of Joseph in his life was to prepare him for purpose. Purpose of his life was not to get up there and be cute and be rich and be famous, because he was second in command in the house of Pharaoh. Wherever he rode, they cheered his name. He had a tremendous chariot. He had a Mercedes chariot, if you will. He had the best of garments. Come on. He had the best of life, y'all. He had the best of living in a strange land. He could have easily forgot about God's purpose. He could have easily forgot about his family because they did him wrong and treated him that way. But because he was a man of God who was developed in the pit, because he was a man of God that was developed in Potiphar's house, because he was developed in the holding place, now when he got to the palace, he was established in God. Amen. It didn't matter that he was second in charge. Didn't matter that he had all that power. Didn't matter that he had all the riches. What mattered was for him to bring God's people into the safe place. To bring God's people into the place of salvation. Come on. The Bible says when he went home finally after the whole story, y'all, this next 3-4 chapters, that he went home and got his daddy. They went home and got his daddy. The daddy that thought that he had lost his son, that thought that he had lost his seed, was finally revived. Jacob's life was blessed at the end. And some of us in here right now seem like the blessing is on the back end. Seem like the blessing has passed you by. Seem like you've lived a life and seem like all the blessings of God have passed you by. But I got good news for you. Your latter will be greater than your former. I wish I had somebody here to believe God today that your last days are going to be better than the days before, that your last days will be days of blessing, that your last days will be the days of milk and honey in your life, that your last days will be the days of your prosperity, that your last day will be the days that you will see all things added unto you. Jacob, just when he thought it was over, salvation came to his house. Just when you think it's over is when salvation is knocking at your door. Just when you feel like it's been too long, God is getting ready to show up. If you're in this place today and you've been believing God for something and it seems like it's taking too long, God told me to tell you that the blessing is knocking at your door.
Yeah.
Don't you give up. Don't you give in. Now is the time to say, Lord, I believe.
Yes.
Say, Lord, I believe.
Lord, I believe.
Come on, say it like you mean it. Lord, I believe.
Lord, I believe.
I believe that you will do just what you said that you would do in my life. And I don't know what you're going through today. You might be having a pit experience. You might be in Potiphar's house in the place of persecution. You might be in the prison in the holding place. And it seems like God is never going to show up. But just in the nick of time, God is going to bring you into the place of the palace so he can bring you into the place of your purpose. What you're going through is to get you ready for what God is going to do. The whole purpose, he sent Joseph to Egypt and let him go through those stages of faith and patience so that he could bring Jacob the promised seed to the place. They said Goshen, y'all, they said it had the best grass, the best cattle, had the best of everything. Look what God did for his people. God used Joseph and allowed God to use him to save his people. It wasn't about Joseph. It was about Jacob.
Amen.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the promised seed of God. God said, I'm preserving my promise. God said, I promised you that I would never leave you nor forsake you. I promised you that you would be a blessed people. I promised you would not only that you would be blessed, but you would be a blessing to other nations. God always protects his promises. So thank God we're people of purpose today. Thank God that your life is on purpose. I don't care what you did last night. I don't care what you did last week. You are a person of purpose. And purpose is greater than your sin. Your purpose is greater than your distraction. Your purpose is greater than the things that you're going through right now. You got to hold on to your purpose. Touch your neighbor and say, hold on to your purpose. God is taking you somewhere. God is moving you somewhere. God is elevating you in the spirit. Why? So he can bring you to a place of plenty. And he can bring you to a place of abundance. Can't you see old Jacob and his old self traveling down that road saying, I'm going to see my son. I'm going. God did not let me down. God did not forsake me. God is the God of the promise. The Bible said they had the best land in the land of Egypt. Now, how are you going to be a foreigner with the best man in Egypt, y'all? Y'all need to hear this. How are you going to excel in the place that they said you wouldn't make it? How are you going to get the job that they say you won't qualify to get? How are you going to touch the lives that God has desired for you to touch if he don't bring you into their presence? And the matter of fact, when Joseph let his emotion go, he was emotional, y'all. He was emotional. He wept twice when he saw his brothers because he remembered how bad they treated him. And then the second week was one day when he said, God's forgiveness is in my heart. When you get to that place where God is calling you, if you have not been built by faith through patience, you would have had all them boys locked up. Let's just tell it like it is. You would have sought revenge. You would have made them pay for what they did to you. But because of what God is doing in your heart, God says, I'm building you for your purpose. I'm building you for the place of prosperity. I'm building you for the place of abundance. Come on, somebody. Are y'all getting this?
Yes.
I'm building you for your breakthrough. I'm building you for your blessing, because when I bless you, I don't want you to forget your purpose. Purpose that I'm here is to be a blessing to you. Not so I can go on the radio, not so I can go on TV, not so I can be some big shot. The purpose that I'm here is to make sure that the kingdom of God comes to pass in your life. Come on, somebody. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. There's going to be some things added to you in this place. Come on, you ain't going to have to struggle for it. You ain't going to have to get in debt for it. God is going to provide it for you. Jehovah Jireh, the Lord God, my provider. I'm done. Can I say this last thing? I was riding in my car, and all of a sudden, I got emotional. Out of nowhere, y'all. This is crazy stuff, man. This is crazy. All of a sudden, I'm riding down the street, and all of a sudden, tears coming out of my eyes. You know what came in my heart? Thank you for my provision. I give you for you right now. Thank you for your provision.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
I thought about all my blessings. In a moment, just that quick. And developed out of me was a heart of thanksgiving. Jehovah Jireh, my provider. It's not about how smart you are. No matter how strong you are, or you think you are, what matters? The Lord God, my provider. Everything I have, He gave it to me. Did y'all hear what I said? This joy that I have, He provided it for me. This peace that I lay down with, my provider gave it to me. Jehovah Jireh, Lord God, my provider. And I thought about how smart I thought I was, how strong I thought I was. And just in that moment, a revelation came. All of this is because of His provision. All because I trusted Him. All because I took a risk to believe what He said to me. Is there anybody here crazy enough to believe what God has said to you? Is there anybody here that's got enough courage today to stand on the Word of God? Is there anybody that has the courage today to be separated from familiarity? Is there anybody here willing to go through persecution? Is there anybody here willing to wait on the Lord and be of good courage? And I can promise you, you'll make the decision to wait on Him today. He will bring it to pass. Eyes have not seen, nor ears heard. Come on, somebody. Stand on your feet while you stand and testify to two or three people and say, I'm on my way to my purpose. Come on, tell them like you mean it. I'm on my way to my purpose. Devil is a liar. God is good all the time. You can't have my family. You can't have my breakthrough. I didn't get my seed in that basket, so make sure to put that down. I won't be the one, praise God. If you don't know the Lord as your Savior today, as your provider, why don't you allow Him into your heart today? God is a God of purpose. God is a God that has plans for your life. The reason why you're frustrated now is because you haven't made that connection with your God to that level of faith where you can believe God to provide for you. And God will make a way for you. God will work it out for you. Stop worrying. Stop going through changes. Give your heart to the Lord. Open up your heart and say, Lord, I trust you, Lord. No matter what I'm going through, Lord, I trust you today. How many gonna trust Him? How many gonna trust Him in this place today? Hallelujah. Come on, give Him a praise if you're gonna trust Him. Glory to God. Hallelujah, Lord. You trust of your life, a life of purpose, a life of God's glory.
Declare that it's well done, Lord. So, God, this is a situation.
successful surgery, Lord. Thank you for your grace and for your blessing. Jesus mighty. Father, the enemy has come against her to persecute her, to attack the call that's on her life, Lord. But today, God, she stands before you with her hands lifted, with praise in her mouth, and with her faith elevated, God. God says, it's your faith that I need. God says, it's your faith that I need, God. So, Lord, as she exercises her faith and belief in you today, God, I pray, God, that you will strengthen her to rise above it all, to rise above every challenge, every persecution, everything, God, is coming against her. Lord, and everything that belongs to her, God, I pray that you would bless her. I pray, God, that you would strengthen her. I pray, God, that you would give her the desires of her heart. I pray, God, that you would give her a financial breakthrough. In the name of Jesus, God, give her, God, the desires of her heart today, God, as she exercises her faith. Thank you for this helper, Lord. We pray for her, God. Thank you for the blessing that you have over her life, Lord. We come, God, against everything that will come against her. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we pray for her mind. Give her courage. Give her, God, fortitude, God, and trust in you. That, Lord, wherever she is and whatever she's doing, Lord, that you're going to bring her through it all time and all right. In Jesus' mighty name. Traveling the highways, we lift them up, Lord, and place them that passes all understanding will be our portion, God. Let us leave this place blessed and anointed, God, to go forth now in the marketplace and be the vessels of purpose that you've called us to be. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.